It's Bullseye. In for Jesse Thorn, I'm Ray Suarez. My next guest is Walter Murch. He's one of the great sound designers in film, and he's an editor, too. You've seen, or heard, I guess, his work on American Graffiti, The English Patient, The Conversation. He's also the subject of a new book, Lawrence Weschler's Waves Passing in the Night. It's a profile of Murch's other great passion in life, astrophysics. Murch spends a good deal of his free time reading up on that subject. He's even become a champion of sorts for a theory once thought long dead. He's also found common ground between the solar system and his day job, finding musical harmony in the orbits of planets, for example. When he's working, he collaborates most often with Francis Ford Coppola. Murch worked on all three Godfather films and, as you'll hear in a second, Apocalypse Now. Here's a clip from one of the film's most iconic scenes.
Big Duke 60 Eagle Thrust. Put on Cywar Op. Make it loud. And the Romeo Foxtrot, Shall We Dance?
Walter Murch, welcome to Bullseye.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Every time I watch that scene, I wonder if it's as complicated to design the sound for as it looks like.
It was the most complicated of all the scenes in Apocalypse Now. I think there were like 260 individual tracks for the helicopters and the AK-47s and the 50 caliber machine guns and the music, of course, and the dialogue, and it was complicated. And this was all before digital. Everything had to be analog. So if you can stretch your mind back in the past, you can imagine what it was like.
It's also a reminder of kind of how we watch movies. When the eye is taking in all the images that are on the screen, the sounds have to somewhat match up with that. But you're also telling people things they're not even consciously aware of while
That's
they're watching.
That's true, and especially with a scene like that, which is so dense with sound, what we found that we had to do was to actually limit the amount of information that we were giving at any one moment. You know, for like every 3 or 4 seconds, we could only feed the audience the music and the helicopters and a little bit of dialogue. But if we also added in all of the machine gun fire and the artillery explosions, it would just collapse into a big ball of noise. So what we wanted to do was give the impression that everything was happening at the same time. But to do that, we had to not show everything at the same time.
And seconds later, almost bizarrely, the sound of the surf has to come in there.
That's right. Yeah.
You have sort of bridged eras. You know, you mentioned the tools that are available today. I'm wondering if, in a movie made that long ago, you had more in common with a Foley man doing radio in a 1940s studio in Radio City in New York than a sound editor does today.
Well, actually, the Foley, which you mentioned, is the live recording of sound effects where the sound effects editors are looking at the picture as they're making the sound, and we still do that today. That is almost completely unchanged from the way we used to do it almost 100 years ago.
When I've talked to people who've worked in the past on sound, in the old days, they talk about sound as a very physical thing. Blocks of wood, dropping shot pellets inside a metal tube to create, you know, using the physical world.
We do that.
Have the machines changed the discipline?
Yeah, well, the thing that's changed is what we record onto. So we're making the sounds pretty much the same way that we made it in the past, but we're recording it digitally, and we can effortlessly combine many different recordings, and then we can squeeze the sounds and chop them into little bits and slow them down and turn them upside down much more easily than we could in the past with analog recording.
But you're still building them in the physical world?
Well, we're looking at computer screens, and we're looking at, it's kind of like looking at the tapestry of a rug. We have these lines of colors, only in this case it's lines of sounds, and we want those sounds to integrate with each other to create a beautiful pattern that also relates, as you said, to what the people are looking at on the screen.
One thing that's changed a lot is the sound reproduction inside theaters. Has that forced you, almost like an arms race, to keep up in the way that you make sounds for movies? Because now the speakers and the immersive aspect of it and the reproduction is just so fabulous.
Yes, and you actually touched on an interesting point, which is that in certainly in Apocalypse Now and films that I work on, what I do is ahead of time look at the landscape of the film, so to speak, and make decisions about where I'm going to use these multi-speaker arrays, and also where I can afford to completely back off that and have the soundtrack simply be mono, you know, just one speaker. And then where I can expand to have maybe three speakers, and then at the right moment expand to five or seven or nine or whatever it happens to be, because people appreciate, in the best sense of that word, they can feel when things are changing. If you made a film which is all channels all the time, after a while people's ears get used to that, and so you're doing all this work, and after a while their ears just say, so what? So what is good is to find a way to sculpt the architecture of the sound so that in keeping with what the dramatic part of the scene is doing, that we are, the sound is, conforming in very interesting ways to what's being shown on screen so that the ears of the audience don't get overly fatigued.
I've had the opportunity, accidentally almost, from time to time, to see movies shot in the outdoors. And the sound that you see in a movie theater isn't anything like what you see when you're watching a scene being shot on the street. For example, I watched John Travolta walk down 86th Street in Brooklyn in the opening that became the opening sequence of Saturday Night Fever. There was a lot going on there, but in fact, the actual sound of the street and him making his way down the street and getting his pizza and all of that is pretty ordinary. Are you, in a way, lying to tell the truth?
Yes, that's, I think Picasso came out with that aphorism, you know, art is a lie that tells the truth, and that's exactly what we're doing. We are doing very complicated things to make the sound seem normal. If we actually showed the real sound that there was at the time of shooting, people would simply not accept it. And it's one of the facts of our profession.
Which even involves, I'm guessing, eliminating the real sounds that are happening around you.
Yes, absolutely. It's artistry is, half of artistry is what you choose to eliminate, almost sometimes more than what you choose to add.
If you're just joining us, I'm with Walter Murch, Oscar-winning film editor and sound designer, and the subject of a book called Waves Passing in the Night by Lawrence Weschler. And this is your other life, really, as an amateur in the best sense, in the 18th and 19th century sense of the word.
Yes, amateur means the lover, the one who loves. And I do love the subject of this book, which is astrophysics and cosmology and thinking about those things.
I'm almost hesitant to try to distill what you're describing for a general audience that hasn't read in on astrophysics in advance.
Let alone trying to do it on the radio.
Yeah, right. Could you give us a thumbnail so at least everybody starts in the same place?
Yeah. When I'm working on a film, I'm working 12 or 14 hours a day, and when I'm trying to get some sleep, I want to go as far away from film as possible so that I can just stop thinking about it for a while. And my drug of choice is science books, biology, cosmology, astrophysics, physics. And this has its effect on me. And I was working on a film in England about 23 years ago, and I learned about something called Bode's Law. And this was an 18th century observation that was made by actually two astronomers. And it was a very simple piece of what you might say is almost ninth grade mathematics. It's a little algorithm, a little formula that has an exponential value in it. And when you chuck various integers into this formula, you get a series of numbers coming out the other end. And the relationship of these numbers to each other is uncannily like the relationship of the distances of the planets from the sun. And at the time that it was formulated, it fit everything that we knew. This is in the mid-18th century. And then, tantalizingly, as we began to discover new planets, these new planets also fit the empty spaces in this formula. So people at that point sort of rolled over and said, okay, this must be a law. We don't know why it is, but it fit the needs of a scientific law, which is to be both descriptive of what we know and then predictive of things that we don't yet know. But as these things come in, they fill the bill.
I don't know much about science itself, but I do know a lot about the history of science and how much of it is told not by experts, not by people who were dedicated to a single-minded pursuit of a vocation from the time they were young, but people who were curious, tinkerers,
yes,
people who tried things out over and over again till they got something to work. And it almost seems like you know, with your day job,
right,
your accolades, your successful career, shelves full of awards, are more in the tradition of those old tinkerers and inquirers than the people who are doctors of astrophysics at universities.
Well, yes, I agree. That's certainly true in the past, probably more true in the past than it is today. But here I am, absolutely throwing myself on the barricades. And in a sense, I'm allowed to do that, or I'm lucky to be able to do that because I do have a day job. And this is my what I choose to do with some of my spare time is investigate these things down this particular rabbit hole. And there are lots of side branches of this study that are fascinating in themselves. But you're absolutely right that a lot of breakthroughs happen because of people just tinkering. Joseph Priestley, who was a cleric in the 18th century, was the person credited with the discovery of oxygen. As it actually turned out, though, he was experimenting with living things, and he would take a glass jar and put it over a mouse, and he would come back 2 days later and the mouse would be dead. And then he tried the same thing with a plant. He put a glass dome over the plant, and 2 or 3 days later the plant would be dead. And then he had this genius idea: what would happen if I put the mouse and the plant together? And he came back 2 days later and they were still alive, and they were still alive a week later, and they were still alive a month later. And what he understood was that the mouse was exhaling something that the plant needed, and the plant was exhaling something that the mouse needed. And ultimately this led to the discovery of the idea of oxygen.
Let's go back to the movies for a minute.
All right.
As the Castro brothers can probably tell you, if you've got big news to deliver, Havana's a great place to do it. Walter Murch, my guest, is known for his work with Francis Ford Coppola on the Godfather trilogy. This scene is from The Godfather Part II, which came out in 1974. It takes place at a New Year's ball in Havana, Cuba, and Michael Corleone is about to tell his brother Fredo he knows he's betrayed him.
Isn't a plane waiting for us to take us to Miami in an hour? We'll make a big thing about it. I knew it was you, Fredo. You broke my heart. You broke my heart.
How do we make sure that we can hear the big band, whoever it is, Perez Prado or whoever is playing in the background, and also hear Al Pacino in the clear and hear what he's got to say?
Well, it's that principle I was talking about before with Apocalypse Now, where we had the helicopters and the music and the AK-47s, the M-16s and the artillery and everything. Is a, you can only call it an artistic understanding of the focus of attention of an audience. What are they capable of taking in, and not to exceed too much any one element. The dialogue in a film really is the spine of the film. You have to understand the dialogue. And that is something, that's what we begin every film with, is that we do what is called a dialogue premix, and that's taking just the dialogue, no sound effects, no music, and we spend sometimes weeks getting the balance of the dialogue itself correct so that it has the right equalization, it has the right frequencies, are all perfectly balanced to give us this possibility of really understanding it. And then we start to add these other elements, the sound effects and the music, and kind of like bringing the water up to just to the right level. We will increase the sound effects just to the right level and no further, so that we're not impeding the dialogue, the understandability of the dialogue.
Is there a further level of complication that comes from the actors themselves? Al Pacino has a very different vocal quality from John Cazale, who he's talking to there on the dance floor in Havana. Do you have to compensate for where in the range of a voice actors have their sweet spot?
Yeah, absolutely. There's a funny story from Godfather 1 where we were recording some extra dialogue from Marlon Brando, and I was working with Francis Coppola and Marlon in a recording studio, and suddenly Francis looked at his watch and said, "Well, I have to leave. I think it's going great. You guys finish the film." So suddenly I was alone in the room with Marlon Brando. I was 28 years old or something, and Marlon Brando was Marlon Brando. And we finished the reel that we had been working on, and then we had to wait 5 minutes to put up the next reel. And in the dark, he suddenly said, "People say I mumble." And so that was a hot potato. I sat there for a few seconds thinking, what's the right answer? And I said, "That's right, they do. They do say you mumble." And he thought for a second, and then he said, "They're right. I do mumble. And I'll tell you the reason why." So I was all ears at this point. He said, "When we shoot these films, we shoot them out of order. We shoot the last scene first and the middle scene next, and then the first scene we shoot at the end of the movie, and it's all a jumble, and I don't know in the end how the real order of these scenes is going to be. Some of the scenes that I think are important get cut out of the film entirely. So as a result, to protect myself, I don't move my lips very much. I just keep my jaw kind of just moving a little bit when I talk, so that when I see the film cut together before it's finished, I can come in and change my dialogue, because I want to compensate for all of the crazy things that you filmmakers have done to it." So that's exactly a version of what you're talking about.
As a piece of acting wisdom.
Yeah.
Did it make sense to a young film editor?
Oh yeah. No, sure. It was a golden piece of information for me.
Walter, let's talk about the partnership with a director. Do you have to make room for each other when you have both complementary and clashing visions of how a scene's going to go?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, the director is the boss. You have to adhere and try to enhance the vision of the director. And we are there, we being the editors and the costume designers and the actors and the cinematographers, are there to figure out what the vision of the director is, either because the director overtly tells us what he wants, or we kind of intuit it. And the best kind of relationships, as you can imagine, are a sort of three-legged race where we're tied together working on this film. We're trying to hit all of the budgets and the schedules that are present in filmmaking. And we have a kind of intuition about what each of us is capable of and what each of us wants. But the ultimate power relationship, if a director finally says, you know, I know you've worked hard on this scene, cutting it together, but in the end, I think we just have to cut this scene out. That's the decision that the director ultimately makes. But having said that, each director has a very different personality and way of working. I worked with Fred Zinnemann, the director of High Noon and From Here to Eternity. And he was somebody who started making films in the 1930s based on him getting interested in films in 1916. So almost the entire history of film is present in that stretch of time. And worked obviously on a number of films with Francis Coppola and Anthony Minghella and George Lucas and Phil Kaufman, and these are all have all been wonderful relationships, and but each person is slightly different.
Sound designer, film editor, and astrophysicist, Walter Murch. Great to talk to you.
Okay, very good to talk to you. Thank you.
Walter Murch. The book about his forays into astrophysics is called Waves Passing in the Night. It's by Lawrence Weschler, and it's a great read. Check it out at your local independent bookstore, Amazon, or wherever you buy books.